afraid of the cleft only let me hide myself in thee. Amen. That's a prayer right there. Giving honor to God, who's always part of my life, to all of our leaders, members of this great branch of Zion. It is good to be here at this sacred desk. I am grateful always for that opportunity to bring a word. It gives me a chance to meditate on it. God's word is so very fruitful. God's word is so very enlightening, gives me life. So I'm grateful for this honor and this privilege. I'm also grateful for my friend Annette. This morning when we were in the office, I said to her, "Oh boy, I think I lost my sermon." So she was just very calm. "Oh, you'll be fine, Reverend." And those words were very helpful because I was able to calm and was able to find my sermon. Hallelujah. You know, these iPads, you know, I'm just really new to this then. And when I tried to copy something and the thing went poof, I was like, "Oh, where do I go?" But then you have the Google search, and I went on Google and I said, "How do I recover a deleted note?" And voila, there was the answer. Right there. And it worked. Oh. So I'm grateful for this technology because it not only allows me not to walk around with paper, but it also allows me to recover when I make a mistake and delete something. But I'm glad to be here today for a moment. We're going to focus in on the subject of radical faith. A radical faith. John Meekin wrote an article that was published in the op-ed of the New York Times entitled, "A Nation of Christians is Not a Christian Nation." He reflected on the late Senator John McCain's visit on the campus of Jerry Falwell's Liberty University. According to the journalist, he expressed that it seemed that McCain picked up some theology along with his academic hood. Mr. McCain repeated what is an article of faith among many American evangelicals. "The Constitution established the United States of America as a Christian nation. According to scripture, however, believers are to be wary of all mortal powers. Their home is the kingdom of God, which transcends all earthly things." Interesting. Not any particular nation state. The psalmist advises believers to put not their trust in princes. The author of Job says that the Lord shows no partiality to princes, nor regards the rich above the poor, for they are all the work of God's hands. Before Pilate, Jesus says, "My kingdom is not of this world." And if, as Paul writes in Galatians, "There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free man, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus," then it is difficult to see how there could be a distinction in God's eyes between, say, an American, an Australian, or those that are part of the Caribbean. In fact, there is no distinction if you believe Peter's words in the Acts of the Apostles, I must certainly believe now that God is not one to show partiality, but in every nation, the man who fears God, the woman who fears God, and does what is right is welcome to him. And those of us who really seek to study and interpret the Bible for ourselves, we learn that the kingdom Jesus preached and taught was radical. Not only are nations irrelevant, but families are too. He instructs those who would be his disciples to give up all they had and all those they know to follow him. Follow him in what way? Well, radically, so that the lives of those that followed would have a transformative, impactful, and life-changing experience. They would also experience a breakthrough. Some of us live in a world where ordinary won't do. Everything that attracts needs to be grabbed and held and hold our attention. These become accustomed to looking around restlessly for something new, the latest and the greatest, that idea or product or person or experience that will solve our problems, give us some purpose and change the world. Their lives have to count. They want to leave a mark. They want to have a legacy and make a difference. They certainly must live up to their Facebook profile, which one writer said is one of the newer versions of salvation by works. While others aren't sure they want to jump on board on a bandwagon or trailblaze new paths to greatness. This group is perfectly content to stay put while family, friends, and acquaintances go off to explore the world and other cities. They don't care about impressing strangers by climbing the corporate ladder or being on the fast track. They just want to invest in the lives closest to them. How many of you can relate to that? These are the ones that call us to compassionate ministry to the poor, to emphasize social justice, and to live out our faith in a way that makes a measurable difference in the world. Instead of growing impatient and harboring a disdain for the ordinary, both the busy and the not so busy are invited to break away from the business as usual, to think outside the box, and to do something big for God. In My Name is Erin, one girl's plan for radical faith, Erin Davis says, I'm not just interested in having a faith in Jesus. I don't just want to check the box for Christian, like crossing chores off a to-do list, and then blend in with the crowd. I want a radical faith that changes everything about life. Let me ask you a few questions. What do you think when you hear the word radical? Do you imagine someone dressed weird, talks weirder, and seems to do whatever it takes to stick out like a sore thumb? Is it a radical, someone who carries picket signs or marches for a cause she or he is passionate about? What about standing up for your faith, even if it costs you? Is that what it takes to be a radical? One of the definitions of radical is very different from the usual or traditional. If one were to do a serious study of the Bible, one would learn that the Bible is a chock full of radical following of God. I won't sugarcoat it. Radical faith has its challenges. But Jesus went first. He showed us what a radical life lived for God's glory looks like. Then he simply said, follow me down the path he's already taken. In our text today, we look in on the points that Jesus is making as an observer to his disciples. He says in Mark 12:38 and 43:44, as he taught, Jesus said, watch out the Lord. They like to walk around like they strut and flowing down the robes and be greeted with respect in the marketplaces. Then he says, as he calls his disciples to him, truly I tell you, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. They all gain out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything all she had to the Lord. In this text, Jesus is calling his disciples' attention to those that serve out of tradition and those that serve in a whole new way. The widow practiced a radical faith. Over the past several weeks, the texts from Mark have revealed a variety of levels of commitment. In response to Jesus' ministry, some people were all in, others were almost all in, and some were all out. The rich man in Mark 10:22 went away grieving, for he had many possessions. He was all out. James and John are willing to be all in if, with the condition, Jesus will promote them to the court office. They're all in if their conditions are met. But Bartimaeus, like our poor widow, is all in. If I've been playing the role of the poor widow, I have put in one coin and kept the other. But that's not how she does things. In this text, Jesus denounces scribes who are all about their own prestige and wealth. Then by contrast, he praises the widow who gives to the max. She is all in. And I thought about someone that I met on yesterday, and he had made a tremendous impact on me. And I've read his books, as part of study at New York Theological Seminary, but I had never heard him. By the time I enrolled in the Masters of Divinity program,